Hello, hello, hello. Testing audio, testing audio. Welcome back to today's podcast. My name is Brittany Simon. To my left, I've got the Calm Tea from Witchwood Tea House. This is one of my favorites. I've had it before on the show. This one is very light, lemon balm, chamomile, rose, and oat straw. Very light, very delicious. Very much recommend. Okay, in today's video, we're going to talk about boundaries. Many of you have asked me to talk about boundaries, so I have a little note card here for myself and a stack of books we're going to explore together. Remember that even though I mention books and I talk about documentaries or I mention people's names, that I believe consuming all is better than consuming none or specific. So I'm not telling you I approve of everyone on this list. I'm not telling you these are even good books. I'm telling you for myself, when I'm consuming, I'm just using it as a chance to learn. So as an example, I'm reading Women, Fire, and Dangerous Things, and this is a really great book. Oh my gosh, it's really, really good. Like, I like it, right? It's about categorization and why we categorize. You guys know when I created the levels, the philosophy system and language that I use greatly on this channel, right? This like whole channel is transformed into just discussing it. A lot of you asked, why do I categorize people? Because we're human and that's what we do. And so for people who feel like, oh no, Brittany's categorizing people because she doesn't like them or she's trying to judge them, just remember I'm trying to understand you. So I don't have to judge you for reals. I only have to gay judge you, which is really just us agreeing to disagree. That's what gay judgment is. It's me saying, I wouldn't do it that way, but okay. I will be patient through this process of your life, right? For the most part. So this is a really good book I would recommend. But there are some books on this little reading list that I wouldn't necessarily recommend because it might not fulfill people in the same way that it fulfills me. So when we talk about boundaries, think of it the same way. The way I think about boundaries might not be the way you think about boundaries, but ultimately boundaries are saying, hey, I have a threshold, I have a limit, and I need you to see it and respect it so we can continue our relationship. Boundaries exist everywhere. When you go to the doctor, there's boundaries. When you're driving, there's boundaries. Hell, between animals and humans, there's boundaries. And though I think humans are evolved animals over time, there are still boundaries even between us humans and so on and so forth. You guys get what I'm trying to say, right? Boundaries exist. I think what we all have struggle or difficulty with is how to put down those boundaries and what those boundaries look like. So for the last my whole life, I have tried my hardest to create boundaries within my family structures and friend structures. I haven't always been good at it. I'm never going to be perfect at it, but I'm trying. So I'm going to give you guys examples of boundary setting, and then I want you to incorporate it into your life, understanding that this is what's worked for me and what I've observed. But I'm sure you guys also have great tactics as well of being open but having boundaries. So share those in the comment sections down below. All right. So the first example I want to talk about is my self-image. Who am I? Who gets to say who I am? I think about this in so many layers. Identity is something we have spoken about a lot on this channel. We've discussed the nuances of identity and how hard it is to really understand people, even though we have these categorizations. So when I think about the self-image, the last group of people I want to give the power to explain who I am to the world is people who don't know me, like a group of people who don't know me. So when I think of my self-image, the only people who are allowed to get intimate with me and describing my self-image are people who have been with me, bled with me, cried with me, laughed with me, grown with me, people who know me in and out. People who are strangers, maybe even you guys as viewers, you can have a certain amount of insight into who I am. And because of that, that parasocial relationship that also exists in our understanding that you guys can't know my core self and I can't know you very well unless we get to know each other intimately, that there's always going to be a boundary there of appropriateness when assessing a person. Even myself, when I talk about Trisha Paytas or Ethan Klein or anybody, remember that I don't know these people. So there's always got to be a healthy boundary in our understanding when assessing people. I think what I am afraid of is people creating an idea of me in their head that they will use to then hurt me.
Oh, hi. Thanks for checking in. I'm still a piece of garbage.
So interestingly enough, we know and acknowledge. It's so funny. I'm watching, which anime am I watching? I think School of the Elite or Elite School or whatever. I think it's in that anime they mention it, that there's so many variations of ourselves in other people's minds. We're always playing with the dichotomy of our identity. So even anime shows it, books show it, everything we know about ourselves, we know there are different versions of ourselves existing in the world. And we know everyone's going to view us how we are and how we are not. And so it's really scary for me as somebody that is in the public eye to be assessed by a mob of people and then they get to decide who I am even though they don't know me. That scares me. It's less scary, I think, in local areas where you have your family and friends, because I've gone through that too, like public ostracization after I came out as queer. Like, I was publicly rejected, but embraced by my inner circle. And so I felt safe. But on the internet, like, I'm a solo YouTuber. I don't really exist like in a group. There's not a gang online that like will come to my defense, and my family's private. So anytime something happens online, I just have to handle it on my own in the public. But emotionally at home, at least I have my inner circle, but it's not the same. Do you guys get what I'm saying? Okay. So self-image, who gets to decide who we are? Well, we do. And then in relation to when the people interact with us, they get to decide how they see us and how they want to interact with us. Sometimes their assessments are wrong and sometimes their assessments are right. But ultimately what they're trying to do is put a boundary on their themselves. But we always phrase boundaries as what we put on other people. So remember, on this channel, we want to remember that boundaries are things we put on ourselves, not on other people. As many of you guys recall, I've told the story 1,000,000,000,000 times, but during one of my cancellations with my stalker, I remember one of my friends being confused about the pipeline of white nationalist rhetoric that I was going down. All part of research of discounting, of course, the narrative of white nationalism, which is pretty easy to discount. Honestly, it's kind of basic at this point. But since there are people who are still living their first times understanding white nationalism and racism and all these things, there's always going to be people who interact with these ideas like they're the biggest, you know, issue in the world. And that's very important. And that's important that we allow them on their journey. But where I am in my journey, right, I'm a person who collects information and I read and consume everything. I'm a person who has a collection of people that you could argue would expose me to negative thinking and put me down a quote unquote pipeline into white nationalism or something negative. But the thing is that when people ask me these questions, and I'm a Middle Eastern queer woman, right, and I just look at them and I understand what they're saying. They're asking me, and am I that weird anomaly, that really crazy person that's going to be so contradictory that they're not going to be able to predict who I am? No, I'm really basic and I'm pretty consistent. I'm a weird person who likes a lot of information and mostly just still is stubborn about what she believes. But ultimately, I know very few things. But what I do understand about humanity and our personhood is that it grows and becomes better when we consume and digest and dissect. And we cannot do that if you're afraid that certain information will lead you down a pipeline. Of course, all humans are susceptible to encouragement of a negative, you know, energy. We are all susceptible to being pulled into negative spaces. We're all susceptible to falling for scams. But that is why knowledge is power. You're so afraid of consuming knowledge because you think it will lead you down a bad path, while not recognizing the path you're on is stagnant. And that is fine. Again, no judgment, just gay judgment. But you can't come at me and say, Brittany, I know who you are because of what you read. Brittany, I know who you are by the people you have sex with. Brittany, I know who you are by the way you vote. How? When you can't even explain my own ideas to me, or you can't even understand where I'm coming from. How can you say you know who I am when you don't even understand what motivates me or what keeps me going? How can you say you know who I am when you ask me questions that are so obviously not true, that you must be living with a version of me that's just so specific? And my question to you is, why did you create that version of me in your head that way? Now, don't get me wrong. Maybe it's me. Maybe it's the energy I'm putting out. Maybe it's my fault how people view me and see me and judge me. To some extent, I think we all have to agree that is true, right? It's not so much victim blaming as acknowledging that we put an image out into the world and we are consumable things. And so people are going to form ideas in their heads with a mixture of what I give them and what they perceive. But sometimes the picture is so off that I have to wonder, how did you create this version of me in your head? And then how can you ask me to then trust you with my life? Because frankly, I don't.
I have a distrust into people. I don't trust human beings. I'm not surprised that this shit would happen. I've seen it before. I've seen it over and over again.
Now, do I trust humans to be overall good? Yes, because I believe they are. You know, that gets proven to me all the time, right? Especially through the discourse that happens here on this channel. I can see that people are interesting and they want to know things and they're not dumb. They're just not exposed. And being not exposed is part environment, part choice. Right now, if you're watching this video, you are officially exposed to the understanding that there is knowledge you could be consuming. So right now, you are now liable for future decisions. Now you can say, I know better. Brittany told me, I heard it. If I can digest this, I can really understand. I have power in my life by what I consume. And that could mean going to a bookstore like I did most of my life and just scanning the books and grabbing one and grabbing one and grabbing one until all of a sudden I was reading thousands of books and I'm sitting here like, wow, when did I ever have time for that? At certain points of my life, I have less time to read, but I'm trying. I get about 20 pages done a day right now. It's not very much, but it's better than nothing. Because eventually this book will be read. I think it's like 600 pages. I'll be done with it soon. You know, ideally, I'd love to read 100 pages a day, but your girl ain't got that time. So instead of, you know, prioritizing reading, which I think would be lovely in so many ways, but a disadvantage in others. I just added a little bit into my life and I make it a part of who I am. Again, what I am consuming, though, is just helping me problem solve what and why and who I am. But it's not literally who I am. I can't be a book. I can't be an idea. I can be a concept in other people's heads, an idea in other people's heads, but my real humanity cannot just be that because I exist. So tangibly, I am so much more, which is why I think you guys see me have so much fear over our radical desire to imprison people, our radical desire to blame people, call people the bad guy, cancel people, is that I've just seen this throughout history repeat and repeat. And I'm just trying to say, are we going to do something different or not? Because if we're not going to do something different, how can you blame people for being selfish? If you're not going to change and you're just going to become the people that you fought against your whole life, whether you're, you know, no matter who you are, it doesn't even matter. Then why should the individual invest in a community that's not going to change? It makes no sense. And I know what you're saying. Well, if you change, the community will change. Well, great. I'm growing and getting better without a community. At least not when I'm beholden to 100%, right? Like, I'm never 100% going to follow along with anyone's beliefs or ideas because I have boundaries with how I interact with reality. So the next part is what I believe. No one gets to tell me what I believe. They can tell me what they think I should believe, and they can tell me what they think my beliefs mean, but they can't tell me what I believe. I believe what I believe, right? Now, do I know what I believe, and can people judge me on that? Probably. Someone could say to me, you know, Brittany, I feel like you don't even know if God exists because you certainly say you believe in him, but you don't act like you believe in him by your actions. Now, of course, that's kind of a shitty example with myself because I don't go to church and I don't believe in a God. But that's something that I noticed with Christians or God believers or Muslims or anything else is that I'm always shocked that people believe in God, but don't just radically change their life around that. Because I feel like I would do that in a heartbeat because I'm so black and white that way. But maybe that's the borderline. Is like, I am obsessed with truth. And if I find out the truth is a God, bro, see you at church, bitch. Like, I'm going to be there every day. But people don't do that. And so I have to assume that they believe in a God, but they maybe don't know. And that not knowing is so deep in their subconscious, so they don't even recognize it. But that doubt keeps them from being devout. Because I always do wonder that, right? Like, isn't that kind of, I don't know, it's sus. You think you know who created the whole literal heaven, earth, and us? I don't know. I think that's what we're all searching for. That's what I want to know. But I also think that realistically, I believe that humans are just these creatures, these organisms that have come over time, right? So I don't really think we're that special, but who knows? Now, of course, that knowing, that believing, that conversation we have with ourselves, that is always being intercepted by other people. People are always trying to say, Brittany, do it this way. Do it this way, guys. Hey, you, do it this way. Even you could argue I am saying, hey, you should maybe do it this way. But what I'm saying is, in my world, I want you just to have the option to do it this way if you want, but literally no pressure. No pressure, right? Because realistically, your journey is your own. And if you want to be any which way, it really should be up to you. Ultimately, right? Now, that moves into how I learn and how I consume. So that goes back to the first part of the podcast where I talked about the books. I just want to share with you why I'm reading certain books, right? So this one's Women, Fire, Dangerous Things. I'm reading it because I want to learn about categorization to better help me explain the levels. These ones are like my political books, right? The Righteous Mind, The Dim Hypothesis, with Why the Lights in the West Are Going Out. This is by Leonard Peikoff, who did Rand's Philosophy on Objectivism, if anyone's interested. That was the student she approved to write her philosophy out. So you might want to check those out. And then Backlash, this is a feminist book. And this is more like, in my opinion, second wave-ish feminists, but more liberal. And then this is Camille Paglia, which is like second wave feminist, but more conservative, weirdly enough, but not really. She's kind of liberal too. Then I have my religious books, right? Like Coveted Happiness about marriage and sex statistics. Edith Stein, she's somebody who people consider a feminist, but Catholic. Buddhism, right? You know, I'm trying to incorporate an eclectic collection of information. If you go down, I have like these really fucked up fictional books like Lolita. Lolita is one of the most controversial books because it's about an older man who's a pedophile in love with this little girl. And it is one of the most beautifully written books. It moved me to tears. I was devastated and I have never felt so moved. Well, so devastated for a person. Like this is a really good book. It could be very triggering for people, but I mean, fuck, sign me up, right? The next one, Exquisite Corpse. This is by Poppy Z. Bright. And they're an amazingly dark Southern writer. They write the most disgusting, vile, drug-induced, rape, trans, people of color, murder, serial killer series of books that I've ever read. I think they're fantastic, and they just make me feel alive. The next ones are fun books like The Midnight Sun or Val Kilmer's biography. All of these things I feel like are not even related, but ultimately they are because they're about people. Whether they're fictional stories or whether they're observing people, they're about people and how we're socializing. And again, all of these books have ideas of how people should be. They all kind of mock slightly here and there other people that they deem less, intuitive or intelligent. There's, compromise in some of these, people trying to work together. There's controversy with Midnight Sun because they think Edward is abusive. Like, I mean, no matter who you are or what you write, someone's going to have an issue with it. And the issue I take with humanity is that it's so easily swayed by what other people think of it that I can never trust it. You are so easily swayed. You are so easily offended. You are so easily in denial that I cannot trust you with my life. And I wish you the best on your journey, but I ask you to leave me alone. And I think that's the thing, is that when I talk about boundaries, I'm talking about putting it on myself by moving away from the world, because I cannot actually ask you to mind your own business, because you won't. Realistically, even me pleading right now is so silly, because people won't. They don't understand boundaries. Someone said to me, I wish stalkers would use the golden rule as a part of their philosophy. Treat people how they want to be treated. They do. They want to stalk and harass you because they want to be stalked and harassed. Stalkers want your attention. So, of course, they're going to literally try to get your attention. And I, like I stated in my last video, not the podcast, but the last video about my 2-year anniversary of being, BPD symptom free or trigger free, when I talked about my stalker and people in my past, like how I just want them to leave me alone, like go be with God, like be better, I mean that. And I mean that because I know ultimately that the boundaries I want to put down, like that is a boundary. Does that make sense? I'm sorry. I know this is muffled, but that's a boundary. I'm saying, hey, I would like space, so I'm going to remove myself from your existence. I ask that you also do the same out of respect for the fact that I don't want you in jail. I don't want you tortured. I want people who've done me wrong to get better and leave me alone. So I'm going to put a boundary myself and not share my location, not engage with people as recklessly, and make sure that I don't over-socialize, because I have a habit of over-socializing with humans because I am not as afraid of humans as I should be. And also I am terrified of humans because they scare me, but that also gets me freaking pumped because it means access to understanding why more. So a little bit of my, I think, addiction with wanting to know the why also comes from, like, that's my adrenaline rush. Otherwise, I'm bored. Existence is great, but unless I am, like, understanding people better, I'm bored. So I always create an environment around me that I can control within my boundaries, because boundaries expose my limitations. So honestly, as much as people might see me as like this really strong and like aggressive person, I want people to also remember my boundaries are in place because I have weaknesses. And I've been pretty forthcoming with my weaknesses because I feel like I have enough of a stronghold. But I didn't always have that. And I didn't have that until I knew why my boundaries were there and why I needed them. And that's sort of the key. So why do we have boundaries? So I have boundaries. For me, I want to live a safe, sane, consensual existence that's risk aware. That is straight up from BDSM. When I joined the BDSM communities, they taught me safe, sane, consensual, and risk-aware kink. These are two belief systems that I actually think work very well together. It's the idea that when you engage in BDSM or any activity in which harm can occur, that you have an awareness level in which if things do go bad, it's less traumatizing. The idea is to know that you're doing something consensually because you want to be there. Even if you feel in the same way you can when exercising that you don't want to be there, so you push yourself through, there is a line between that being okay and a line between now you've ruined the opportunity to have a good time because something unconsensual happened, or there weren't boundaries in place and so someone else took advantage of you, right? So either way, if you adapt this philosophy into your life, you could at least create boundaries that keep you safe, sane, and consensual. Because that's kind of like the key to interaction. Now, it's not always perfect and life is messy and things will go wrong and people will cross boundaries and there will be consent violations and you can move all through that, in therapy. But the point is that you still have strength. You know who you are. You need to put boundaries down that reflects that. I want to have a safe life. I haven't always been safe. And to be completely transparent with you, I have sometimes outright risked my life and sometimes even put myself in situations where I wished I would die. Which is why I think sometimes I've experienced things that for other people made them take their own life. And for me, I processed almost as something I deserved. And so a part of it was more survivable for me. Because to be honest, I put myself in situations that were dangerous because I didn't have a stronghold on my boundaries. When I was in my early 20s, I would just like go to parties and drink. And I was definitely one of those people that was trying to die, but I didn't want to kill myself. But I tried to kill myself, but kind of sloppy. And I think all of you know what I mean when you're a suicide attempter, when you have suicidal ideations. There's like a line between kind of like half-assing your suicide attempt and like going straight up for it and like swallowing bleach, which, you know, dedication. But it is one of those things where I think the subconscious protects us sometimes from dying because there's a deep part of us that really doesn't want to die. And then there's a part of us that's so lost in our mania, it feels the same and it doesn't matter. So you can be all kinds of versions of this and some I haven't even named. So, you know, your experience is your own. But for me, boundaries taught me to be safe because in my early 20s, I drank a lot and went to places and I was kind of, I had this mindset of, you know, I don't want fentanyl in my Coke, but if I snort it and there happens to be fentanyl and I die, you know, more power to me because I just wanted to die. I just didn't want to die. I don't know. There was a part of me that was still holding on. And I think to get to this Brittany, right, the person I am today. But at that time, that Brittany was reckless and she got assaulted. She didn't ask to get assaulted, but she put herself in a situation that, I hate to say it, made it perfect for somebody to assault her. And I know this sounds crazy, but I am like kind of really smart and really stupid at the same time. I'm a person who's book smart enough to have read all these books and consumed information and know people. But yet I'm like, at least in my past, I've been so romantically naive. So emo naive. So just like broken naive. And that naivety was definitely exploited by myself. There was like two Brittanys growing up my whole life. The one that says, ooh, let's touch the fire. And the one's like, I don't want to touch the fire, though. And I live with that Brittany all the time. There's definitely a part of me that's like, play with the dark energy. Oh, my God, play with this dark energy. And then a part of me's like, Brittany, step away from the dark energy, right? But there is definitely that side of me that exists. And so boundaries helps protect me. Again, so I don't drink or get high with strangers unless I'm in a situation where I know I want to have sex with them. Because I have a tendency to be a little bit of a succubus and I utilize, you know, I feel people's like energy and I know what they want. And so I had to learn how not to give in to what people wanted just because I could give it to them. And I think girls and boys and people who can feel a lot of empathy, who know like, oh, that's what that person needs, like really needs. And I know I can give it to them because I know what they need. See a need, fill a need. But the problem is like, it's not who I am. So it paints a false narrative of I've given this thing to this person that seems like everything they've wanted, but I can't keep it up. It's kind of like when 22-year-old boys hit on me, which guys, I really appreciate. Trust me. Like when you call me mommy, I feel like my whole life makes sense, right? I love that. But I am not this consistent top mommy energy. Only when I'm around someone who's so bottom to me, it comes out, but it's not consistent because it doesn't fill my spoons as fast as me being a bottom. And that's so weird, right? Because again, the BDSM trope of like dominant personalities at the workplace or submissive personalities in the dungeon is a trope that fits me. Again, I am not the exception. Like I said in my last video, and so I need boundaries because I'm not the exception to rules. I am like most humans. I make mistakes. And I am reckless with my body when I am put in certain situations. And a big part of that is, like I said, I love to know why. And I want to know what this is like. And I want to know what this is like. There's a reason my life has gone the way it has. And now that I have boundaries, my life, again, can be risk-aware kink, safe, sane, consensual. I can make decisions that on the outside could be dangerous for the average person, but because I'm well-versed in it, less so. It's like anything in BDSM, right? I'm not going to let just anyone carve, you know, or do a scarification scene on my leg. I'm not just going to let any Joe Blow put needles in my thigh. We're going to go take classes. We're going to make sure you know what you're doing. We're going to have, you know, negotiations. There are steps you can take in your life to have a better outcome. without orchestrating this concept of a life that is so perfectly manicured. My sister and I talked about this last night, where she says, sometimes I talk in a way that makes me sound like I can predict the whole future, but I can't. I can just predict basic human behavior because I'm a basic human and I understand it. I understand that when people are hungry, sometimes they get hangry. I understand when people are in quarantine, sometimes they get horny. I understand that all of these things, right? It's basic stuff that I feel like people are, they know. I know they know because they share it on their Twitters. They know it in themselves. They know it in other people. But it's like when I talk about it, it makes people uncomfortable. So again, if you're uncomfortable, you know, that's something you need to work out with your subconscious, right? You need to have a conversation with yourself. Why is your subconscious upset? Because it's not me, because I'm nobody. I'm just like a blob of energy also interacting in this blob of energy world. So you can't really be mad at me, right? And I think that's why I'm not really as upset with people, generally speaking. Because I think what they do makes a lot of sense. Now, if something doesn't make sense, then I start to question, like, why? Now, again, all of this is how my brain works in order to create the reason for the boundary. So the why. Protection, safety, consistency. I build structure through boundaries. I teach my brothers that they cannot disrespect the home that we live in by putting down boundaries and sticking to them and having consequences for actions. I put myself under those boundaries. If I break something, I fix it. The other day, because my muscles are so big, I broke the kitchen sink. I broke the faucet right off, as you guys know, and I had to replace it. $200, that's on me, right? I did that. I did it. I don't complain. I don't beat myself up. I just go, okay, Brittany, I got it. You broke it. You fix it. And that's it, right? That's what you do. I don't wait. I don't try to get it done in 7 months. I don't save up. I don't complain. I put it as a priority. I damage something that universally impacts the house, and I damage something that was not mine. We're renters. So I fixed it. That is how I expect people to behave when interacting or living in my close quarters. You do something, you fix it, right? And I understand things are complicated and other things could be more than a faucet and it could take a lot longer, but as long as you're working on it. Because stagnation breeds moisture, which breeds musk, which breeds stinkiness. And I ain't gonna have my house stinky, okay? Stagnation, gross, not into it. But there are going to be times when which we're stagnant, and that's when boundaries are so necessary. Stagnation breeds negative energy. And so you run the risk of being easily influenced by people who could come and rock that stagnation and surprise you. Sometimes when we're stagnant, we're rocked by other people's energies and we think, oh, this is the thing that's getting me invigorated. I should go do this thing. But if you don't have boundaries set down, you will have the wrong people come into your life and uproot you from your stagnation instead of moving you forward, taking you 20 steps back, or God forbid, down, where then you have to climb back up and still head on the road, right? If this is linear. So again, boundaries are going to be so subjective to you that it wouldn't even make sense for me to share my boundaries with you, but I'll give you some examples. So as a boundary, if I am upset or use any of my safe words, I've taught my siblings like safe word words, like I'll say red, or I'll say like red, I can't do this, or like, you know, I'll have certain body languages that I use. If I am upset, it is my responsibility to put down a safe word, to create a boundary and say, I will continue this conversation later. I need to go away and calm down. I am upset. I am sorry, right? This is putting the boundary on me. I'm not saying you're making me upset. I'm not saying this is your fault. I'm saying I seem to be reacting this way, even though I don't want to because I consider myself level-headed, but apparently I am not. So I will put this on me and I will say, I need a moment. This is something I could not do in the past. In the past, I am an engager, my friends. I am an engager. I am a puffer. I puff my chest out. I get really loud, but now I don't do that. Sometimes I might make mistakes or maybe I'm not perfect about it, but I really have a system down. It's really helped communicate, you know, my feelings to my family. It's really helped them understand like, hey, that joke went too far, or hey, that joke didn't go far enough. Let's go further. Or hey, here are new boundaries and limitations. All because we incorporated a language into our communication that's separate from our normal way of speaking. Like in BDSM world, safe words are kind of common, but they're meant to jar the conversation. They're meant to jar in the middle of the scene. They're meant to trigger your brain to going, oh, something's wrong. So I incorporate that into the language with my siblings and it helps. It really does help. But again, I had to learn about BDSM. I had to be introduced to BDSM. I had to meet the person who mentored me. I had to read all the books on BDSM to even start incorporating this idea into my life because BDSM has a culture of consent and negotiation. So again, my lived life gave me the tools to create boundaries in my life. So boundaries aren't just a matter of, let me just put down some arbitrary rules. They're a reflection of what your life has told you about who you are. And then on opposite of that, you're now going to use that information to tell the world who you are. So another question that I know will come up is, Brittany, what's the difference between having boundaries and knowing your limits and missing out on opportunities? One leads to mania, craziness, psychosis, lack of income, lack of stability, a lesson instead of a lifelong partner, you know, all these things. And one leads to joy and happiness, consistency, and ability to move forward and remain non-stagnant. So, okay. One, again, boundaries is your point of power, your literal tool to communicate with the world. You know, guys, that sounds great. I would love to go to that party. I'm going home by 10 p.m. because I'm an old lady and I need to get some sleep because I have responsibilities and I have to go to work tomorrow. Or actually, I need less sleep, so I'm still going to come out with you guys, but my limit is 3 a.m. and I'm going to wake up at 6 because I only need 3 hours of sleep. Still a boundary. Still a boundary. Still a boundary. They just look different, but they both play to the strengths of the individual. Play to the strengths of you. My boundaries make me stronger. My boundaries say, hey, I would love to hang out with you, but in order to do that, I have to go to sleep tonight because I want to be a person tomorrow. I have borderline. I have an issue. And if I don't get enough sleep, I will possibly get triggered. And then guess what? I'm out for 2 weeks instead of having fun with you for the next 2 weeks. You know what I'm saying? So again, I'm playing to my strengths by creating boundaries. And again, everyone's boundary is going to look different. Everyone's version of what is healthy for them at this moment in time is going to look different. Again, as I was forming my boundaries, obviously I had to have some of them slip up. I had to, you know, make a statement saying, hey, if you do this, it's a boundary and I'll do this. And then when people did it, I didn't do that thing. And I was like, uh-oh. And then I realized, oh, maybe my boundaries aren't that strong. Then I realized my boundaries have to be connected to my values. So this adds the other layer of where you have to know yourself to know how to put down boundaries. Why is knowing yourself so key to everything? Because it's exactly what's going to bring you your happiness. Like, it's really simple. Like, everything is simple. All the answers to the universe are simple, but we're not doing the simple things. I really was not doing the simple things in my 20s, guys, because I did not believe, like a stubborn child, that it could be so simple. But it's true. If you eat, sleep, and have shelter, you're pretty good. Now, we live in a world where that's not always accessible to people for different reasons. And that's hard. And that's, again, your story in the whole world's history. That's your story. Just like our ancestors had history, just like we read about our people, someone in our lineage has to be the person who suffers. And I think in many ways, like, I was that person. You know, not that my siblings and I try to do this often, but sometimes somebody will say something like, I had it the worst. And I'm like, oh, excuse me, are we going to play that game? And then all of a sudden you have all the kids start popping up their heads about who had it the worst. And in the end, the truth is we all had it different. I mean, obviously one of us had it worse, and I don't want to like point fingers, but you know, it is one of those things where it doesn't ultimately matter. Ultimately, what matters is that we got better and we can joke about who got it the worst. I think that is really awesome because before, oh, it would have triggered me. Even mocking the idea that our childhood was hard even for a second would have triggered me. And now I'm like, yeah, it was hard, but it seems like everyone's life seems to be hard. Everyone I talk to has struggle. It just looks different. And that's it. That's literally it. It just looks different. And I'm not so arrogant as to assume that mine has to matter to everyone. So again, we put down boundaries to help communicate who we are. One of the tools I've been using lately has really helped me. And I'll say to people who really want to hang out with me, they'll say, Brittany, I really feel like we should be friends. I think we have a lot in common. I think it would be great. And I say to them, you know what? I love that you would want to honor me with a friendship, but I really don't think that this is the path I want to go down. And again, it's not a matter of that person not being worthy. It's a matter of thinking to myself, is this an energy that I really see flourishing in the same way they do? No, I don't. And so I'll say that as well. I'll say, you know, I don't see it the same, but not because you're not great, but because I think you would be better suited for this kind of a friendship. And I'll usually know what kind of friendship would go great with them. I'll say to them, you know, oh my gosh, like, I feel like you'd be great with like D&Ders and tabletop players. And they'll say, yeah, actually I love D&D. And I'll say, great, I don't like D&D. I don't think we're meant to be friends. And it's not that my friends don't have different hobbies than I do, but a lot of my friends, we share a lot of the same important things. Again, I already have my inner circle, and it's because we all are very similar, even when we're very different, but we're not too different. How do I say this? It's always about playing to your strengths, even in friendships. Even friendships should be a strength, in my opinion. But what happens when they're not? What happens when you have toxic people in your life? How do you have boundaries with toxic people? As you know, I have a one in my inner circle and I love them to bits and pieces, but I have a very strict boundary with them. It's different than other people and it's special to who they are because I respect them as an individual and therefore they get rules associated with themselves. This is why I don't like general laws, because I think the fairest society is a society that has different rules for everybody.
Oh my God.
As an example, how I run my family is that every sibling is an individual and every single person has their own mental health capabilities, resources, physical capabilities. They have like limitations with income, or maybe they have, you know, whatever it is they have that makes them them. That means I have to treat them as an individual based off those things. If I treated my sister like I treated one of my brothers, like it wouldn't make sense. They're not the same people. They don't have the same brains. Like they don't have the same diagnoses. Like it wouldn't make sense, right? Well, that's how I see the world. I want to treat you guys like people, individuals, even when we can be tropey and grouped together. Like I can most certainly be grouped with a lot of people, right? I still want to be treated as a person. And that just makes me hate people less, and it makes me have strong boundaries attached to my values, attached to how I see humanity. When I say I want to hang out with you, I don't have the energy. I'm honest. I don't have a lot of energy. Ask Kioti how often he will call me and I'm like, no, I don't have the spoons. Like I don't have it. I want to have it. I want to be accessible to thousands of people and have just endless amount of energy, but I don't. So I don't put down boundaries because I don't want to hang out, and I don't put down boundaries because I don't like you. I put down boundaries because I like me more, and I will protect me over anyone else, because a useless me is not going to help me, and a useful me is a well-rested me and a me with boundaries. Again, always playing to my own strengths so I can be a good friend and a good YouTuber and a good person and a good sister. If I let myself become mentally unwell again, I am not going to be a good participant in my community. Right now, I'm like running a high of being the older sister who has a place where people live. And yes, they contribute and they all do chores and stuff like that. And some pay rent and that's great. But they don't even have to. I just like them here and I like them participating in this house and I like us living together. And I like that we're, you know, like a big old anime guild just hanging out all the time. I love it. We're working from home. We're all taking breaks together. You know, it's just really beautiful. But we have boundaries with each other, and that's why it is so harmonious. When there's an issue, we talk it out. Even if the energy is high and uncomfortable, we have to have those conversations. And we have them because we love each other. We put down boundaries because we love each other. You know what I mean? It's about respect. It's about seeing people. So when you put down boundaries, put it down because you respect. And understand it's okay if you're in the middle of your trauma journey, because I know when I was, putting down boundaries was so hard for me. I just fucked up so many times and I changed them constantly and I was confusing and I didn't know how to convey them. So don't worry that it's going to be messy, because there will come a point where it's going to be harmonious. But you have to get through it. You have to try. You have to read the books or watch the YouTube videos or listen to the people or consider your life and what do you want for it. Free will exists. You have to activate it in your brain and remind yourself you're not just fucking... Nobody wrote you. Nobody's written your story yet. It's not written for you yet. You still can write it the way you want to write it. No one is writing your story. Even if the world keeps telling you they are, they're not... Don't allow them to. Put that boundary on yourself. Say, in public, as I'm interacting with existence, I will be cohesive and I'll understand how to best play my cards appropriately. But at home, when I'm by myself, be honest with yourself about who you are and what your boundaries are and why you have them in place. Because there is nothing better, dude, than sitting on your kitchen counter, high as fuck, looking yourself in the mirror and being like, what up, bitch? We did it. We did it. We found a way to move within the chaos without losing ourselves in it. It's so good, guys. It is so good. And I think I have such hope for humanity because I see it every day. So excuse me if I'm being too optimistic, but I do think if you want to go on the journey, you can find it. But you have to start with yourself. You really got to start with yourself. So to sum it all up, boundaries are about power, safety, consistency. They're about values. They're connected to everything that we do and they keep us consistent so we can remain our best selves. Find your values, find your boundaries, do all of it at the same time. Do everything one at a time. Do it how it works for you. Seek out your joy and everything else will fall into place. One last part that I want to swing into really fast. Seasonal depression is around the corner. It's going to feel like you're out of control, and it's going to feel like you're going to need boundaries more than ever. Start putting them down. Put them down slowly with yourself. Say, you know what? I want to go out with you guys tonight, but I really got to drink my 15 glasses of water. Drink your goddamn 15 glasses of water, and then go out and have fun. Treat your body with dignity so you can live the life that you want, undignified or not. There is something ironic about existence, those tiny contradictions that I really need you guys to fuck with. It will change your life. Listen to me. You want to go out and party and be undignified, throw out and vomit on the street, even take a piss behind a building? Make sure you do it when you're hydrated. So you can, you know, do it again and again as many times as you want. Think about investing in yourself, right? I know with seasonal depression around the corner, a lot of people are going to really disregard how important it is that their environment is ready for it. Change up your environment. I myself, through winter, through summer, always have a very floral room, very white, very bright, very neutral colors on the carpet. I do not want darkness. That is what the closet is for. As a friend said to me the other day, the best place is a little closet. You know, jump into a closet. It's dark. It feels like a cave. It's nice. My bathroom plays a cave role, but my bedroom has to be large and open because I know with the winter coming, we have snow. I'm going to be trapped in the house. I'm going to need this idea of warmth because I'm a summer baby. I'm a water baby. I'm an earth baby. I do not like the cold. I do not like the winter. I don't like it. I don't. So again, all these things are coming. You can plan for them. You can get ready. Humans, we do these things on repeat. Every year we do the same things, the same energies, and then we wonder why our life is the same. Prepare this winter. Start being cognizant of yourself. Work on your values, what you want is your goals, and incorporate that into your boundaries. Say, you know, guys, by the end of winter, come spring, I want to be 15 pounds lighter. I want to gain 15 pounds of muscle. Start working on that goal. Don't overshoot. Undershoot, because ultimately we're all lazy and we're going to choose a path of least resistance and we're going to have a moment where we're lazy and, you know, don't beat yourself up. What I tell myself is do at least as many push-ups as I can today. Do at least as many push-ups as I can today. And I do it. And every time I feel like I'm almost done, I try to do at least two more, right? That's how I get myself going. I don't say do 50 push-ups because like, girl, come on. But like, I try my best to give myself an attainable goal because future Brittany really wants to be more in shape than this because she wants to be muscular and she wants to lift herself on this pole. That is, I just can't do it, guys. My grip strength and my wrists, my core, everything is too weak to lift my body right now. So I'm working on it. I'm doing my pull-ups and my, you know, chin-ups and all these things. But let me tell you, I could be doing more, but I can't be doing more because otherwise I'd be doing more. I'm doing the best I can and it's okay, right? Even I will want to get prepared for winter, seasonal depression, things that are consistent to make sure that I don't fall into it so I can have another year of no depression, right? And that's going to involve active participation in my life, not just letting it pass by. Again, I'm telling myself, hey, Brittany, you have to be disciplined by creating boundaries and not crossing those boundaries, saying, hey, I'm open, but I really got boundaries. I love it. I want to hear this information. Look, let's go down. Actually, one more example I'll give you. Here's a Middle Eastern goodbye for you. Okay. Where is this book? There it is. There is this book in here that I'm about to read that is so outside my comfort zone because anything about like aliens or space or gods or lizard people or anything to do with like reincarnation or anything to do with things that I just think are a little too magical for me. I haven't explored it as much as I could, but I'm open to truth. So if, you know, if it's true, then I'll believe it or not believe it. I won't have a choice. It's going to be true. See, I just did it with my own language. So this book I have by like Dolores Cannon, someone really recommended it to me. It's called Five Lives Remembered. I'm excited to read it. You know, this idea of like reincarnation and past lives. If it's true, great. If it's not, cool. I read a cool thing about a group of humans who believe a thing is objective. Again, interacting with two bubbles will be endless. I will never, ever get to know the whole world before I die. So I'm going to explore a new bubble and I'm excited, but I'm going to have boundaries. The boundaries are, don't expect me to all of a sudden jump to your side or not put you in your place if I think this is bullshit. So again, with all that said, we're putting the boundaries on how we allow people into our energy, into our identities, into our lives. And I think people have a really hard time with that right now. I think that's why people want to do cancel culture and care what J.K. Rowling says or Dave Chappelle. If you asked my parents like who some of these people were, they'd be like, what? Who? Who fucking cares? Like my parents just do what the fuck they want. They live their life. They have their kids. They have their Christ. As long as they can have their Catholic church, they're fucking happy. Because they know at the end of the day, all the other people are crazy, which is funny, right? You would think if you know you're the right one, why are you being crazy? Ethan said that the other day on Leftovers. It was so funny. He's like, the Democrats have the truth on their side. Why aren't they doing better? Because, Ethan, you're twos and you think the Democrats have the truth on their side. You're so fucking ignorant. I love humans. They're my favorite thing in the whole world. Ooh, they just get me going. But I got boundaries. I got boundaries with how I interact with people who are so confident of something so easily disproved. It's just so easily disproved. And I mean that as somebody who's literally so cynical, but how I disprove things is just face value, people. The Democrats have the answers. Is that objective? The Democrats have the answers. The Democratic Party, who has a history of... Anyways, but we're all ignorant. We're all going to make mistakes. Talk about boundaries. I told somebody this. I was like, guys, you don't understand. I'm not saying that I haven't read the material on the vaccine. I'm saying I literally don't understand it enough to even articulate it to you. It is sciencey stuff. I didn't go to school for this. I don't know what I'm reading. Like, I don't know how you're all reading it and understanding it. Like, fuck, I guess I'm just stupid. But like, I don't know what's in that vaccine. I'll take it to travel, but I still don't know. And I don't know if you guys know that. Like, I don't know things. And I know everyone wants to say, like, I know that, but do you know? Like, if I asked you a question right now, could you just know it without Googling it? Because I sure as hell don't. And so I put boundaries on how people get to decide who I am when they're sitting here, apparently geniuses. I'm just stupid, I guess. You know what I mean? Like, why are you coming? Why are you punching down, bro? Why are you punching down? This is the most ridiculous Middle Eastern goodbye. I'm going to go. Thanks for watching. Have a great day. See you next video. Bye.
I don't know where to go. All I know is how much I don't know. I don't know what I'm seeing. Sometimes it feels more like believing. And I'm so tired of always doubting my own thinking. I had three wishes. One of them would be to have conviction.